open space for you to come and have your way. I am open, I am open. My heart is an open space for you to come and have your way. I am open, I am open. An open space for you to come and have your way. I am open, I am open. My heart is an open space for you to come and have your way. I am open. Space for you to come and have your way. I am open, I am open. My heart is an open space for you to come and have your way. I am open, I am open. Your way, I am open. call me friend. Mercy receives me and lifts me to my feet. And I'm caught up in the wonder and mystery of knowing Jesus, of knowing Jesus. An open space for you to come and have your way. I am open, I am open. My heart is an open space for you to come and have your way. I am open, I am open. And do whatever you wanna do, and say whatever you wanna say, move however you wanna move, change whatever you wanna change.
To your will,
open space for you to come and have your way. I am open. I am open. My heart is an open space for you to come and have your way. I am open. I am open. Space for you to come and have your way. I'm open. I'm open. Oh, I am open. my trust. I give you my trust, Abba. I belong to you, yeah. Oh, Abba, I belong to you.
Lord, hear my only cry to
to know you all my life, all my life. Oh, how your love washes away every fear, washes away every fear. It washes away every fear. Your love washes away every fear, washes away every fear, washes away every fear. Oh, how your love washes away every fear. It washes away every fear, washes away every fear. Oh, how your love washes away every fear, washes away every fear, washes away every fear. Oh, how your love washes away every fear. Breaks through all my defenses, breaks through all my defenses. Oh, how your love washes away, washes away every fear. Oh, how your love washes away, washes away every of the accuser, the voice of the accuser, a voice that says, what have you failed? What have you failed? Oh, how perfect love washes away every fear, washes away every fear, washes away every fear, till I am truly yours. Washes away every fear, oh, you're washing away every fear, you're washing away every fear, till I am wholly yours. I am wholly yours. Till I am wholly yours. Oh, how your love changes everything. Oh, how your love changes everything. Changes everything. Till I am fully, till I am wholly yours. And all I want is just to know your heart, and would you keep me here until we're your thoughts are my thoughts, till your ways are my ways. Oh, there's no fear in God. Oh, there's no fear in God, till your ways are my ways, till your thoughts are my thoughts. Keep me here till you and I are one, till you and I are already started. Hope is rising up. Hope is rising up. Hope is rising up. You will finish what you started. You will finish what you started. Hope is rising up. Rising up, hope is rising up, hope is rising up. You will finish what you started, you will finish what you started.
Springing up from this old ground.
something beautiful, something beautiful. Just what you're doing, you know just what you're doing, you know just what you're doing.
transform us and to speak to us. So today we'll be meditating on and praying through Romans 8, verses 18 through 27. I invite you to open up your Bibles and join us as we pray and meditate and sing through this passage. Once again, the passage is Romans 8, verses 18 through 27. Romans 8, verse 18. For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory that is to be revealed to us. Jesus, we know that you willingly sacrificed yourself for the joy set before you. You saw ahead. You knew that the pain was necessary in the moment. But you also knew that you'd be resurrected and you'd be exalted to God's right hand, that you would get your inheritance, us, your people. And Lord, it's the same joy that we're asking for tonight. Joy that will allow us to see beyond our current suffering and circumstance on earth, and to revel in the fact that because of your sacrifice and your status as the firstborn, we get to join you in glory. We are justified, we're sanctified, and we're ultimately glorified in you. We rejoice in the hope of your glory. For we don't just get to see it from afar or observe it from a distance. We get to partake in it and to experience it ourselves. Our bodies will be resurrected and glorified. Our perishable bodies will put on the imperishable. Our mortal bodies will put on immortality. For death has lost its power and its sting. For while we were meant to go into further decay, destruction, you saved us and you made us new, and you brought us into a renewal process where, although our bodies seem to be wasting away, our inner selves are renewed day by day. And when you return, Jesus, when we are glorified, both our physical bodies and our inner selves will be in unbroken fellowship with the Father, enjoying you as you originally intended for us to. And we eagerly await that day, that eternal glory. We fix our eyes and our hopes on that eternal glory, where you will have your full inheritance in us, and we will have our full inheritance in you.
I was made for glory. My eyes on you. fix my eyes on you. Fix my eyes on you, Jesus. Fix my eyes on you. Fix my eyes on you. Fix my eyes on you. Jesus, fix my eyes on you. Fix my eyes on you. Fix my eyes on you. Jesus. Let this vision of glory glory. of your glory. Oh, this life is but a breath. This life is but a breath. I can almost see the finish line. I can almost see your face. I can almost see the finish line. This life is but a breath. This life is but a breath. Oh, this life is but a breath. In the light of your glory, this life is but a breath. In the light of your face, life is but a breath. In the light of your countenance, I can almost see the finish line. I can almost see the finish line. See the finish line. Oh, this life is but a breath. This life is but a breath.
Romans 8, verses 19 to 23. For the creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the sons of God. For the creation was subjected to futility, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be set free from its bondage to corruption and obtain the freedom of the glory of the children of God. For we know that the whole creation has been groaning together in the pains of childbirth until now. And not only the creation, but we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for adoption as sons, the redemption of our bodies. Lord, you give us not only joy and expectation for the glory ahead, show us that we're not alone in our present suffering. All of creation longs and groans. All of creation is subjected to futility and decay. All creation lives in this tension of a knowledge that greatness is to come and that a sanctifying suffering lies between now and then. Give us eyes to see beyond our personal circumstance of futility and pain. Give us bigger perspective and understanding of a collective longing. And let this collective longing give us even a taste of the longing that you feel for us. The longing you have to be restored fully to fellowship with the ones that you love and you gave yourself for. The ones who reject you still and choose the path of destruction or futility, even though you've provided another way. Allow us to feel that groan, that dissatisfaction, that it may drive us to stand even more firmly in freedom, in victory from corruption and death, into a world that's experiencing the disastrous effects of sin and separation from the Father. Let us be a sign that you subjected creation to futility, but you subjected it in hope. From the start that you would make a way to freedom, to adoption and redemption. Let us walk in victory against what the weight of sin and fleshly corruption around us says. For Lord, we rejoice that we have obtained freedom in becoming your children. And we long, God, we long alongside the rest of creation. We long for the adoption of your sons, the revealing of the victorious ones.
Oh, there's a is coming to its end. The night is coming to its end. The night is coming to its end.
You see the dawn. You know the dawn is coming.
The night is coming to its end. Be revealed. children of God. They will be revealed. 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 For we carry the first fruits of the Holy Spirit. We carry the first fruits of the Holy Spirit. We have the first fruits of the Holy Spirit. We have the first fruits of the Holy Spirit. A sign of a kingdom to come. A sign of the kingdom to come. We have the sign of the kingdom to come. Alive in us. Alive in us. We have the sign of the kingdom to come. The sign of to come alive in us, the sign of the kingdom to come. He's alive in us, he's alive in us, the sign of the kingdom to come.
Sealed your promise by giving us
the sign of the kingdom to come.
This kingdom fast approaching.
a taste of the kingdom of heaven. We get a glimpse of this kingdom of heaven alive in us. A taste of this kingdom of heaven alive in us, alive in us. The world will see a glimpse of this kingdom of heaven alive in us, alive in us. They will see, they will taste. See, the world will taste this kingdom of heaven alive in us. They will see, they will taste this kingdom of heaven alive in us, alive in us.
Romans 8. Verse 24. For in this hope we were saved. Now hope that is seen is not hope. For who hopes for what he sees? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience. Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. We do not know what to pray for as we ought, but the Spirit Himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. And He who searches hearts knows what is the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. Father, upon being adopted as your children, we became children of hope with a deposit of your Spirit in us, whom we cannot see. We are no longer subjected to futility, but to hope. We've obtained glorious freedom, yet we have become slaves to righteousness and hope. So God, we don't want to align ourselves with the thinking of this world of hoping little, to be disappointed little, of keeping our expectations low so that we won't be crushed. But even when it requires much faith and it's scary to believe, we know that this is what pleases you, and this is what walking as a slave to Christ is. God, won't you give us greater faith and true hope to reach for the things that we cannot see yet, that we can't even see a sign of yet. Because we know that when we hope for what we can see, near or far, we don't need that much faith. But you are the God who brings life out of nothingness, and you call us to prophesy and speak forth the same. So give us courage to dream again, to hope again. Give us courage to face what we think is disappointment. As you say that your true hope doesn't disappoint. So if we feel disappointed, won't you speak into that? Help us to process that and show us how it's perceived failure or perceived injury, but ultimately it's your wisdom and your love, it's your healing, it's your gracious refining in us. Speak to us, God, and call forth the true living hope within us. Let your Holy Spirit pray through us and edify us. Bring us into alignment with your hope.
Right now, won't you breathe upon us?
fresh hope.
Breathe on these dry bones. Come alive.
With you and revealing the sons of God in the earth. God, get your glory. Get all the glory in our messy process, in our weakness, and in our revelations. Come and get your glory, God, in it all.
Of God upon these dry bones.
Rosh Hashanah, we'll actually be praying through topics regarding Rosh Hashanah. And we believe that it's important to acknowledge the Jewish traditions and holidays that are laid out in Scripture because they're an invitation to deeper revelation of Christ, to see how everything points back to Jesus, and to pray that revelation of Christ as well over the Jewish people. So to give a bit of background, Rosh Hashanah means head of the year, and it's the first of two high holy days listed in the book of Leviticus. And it's both a time of celebration and of solemn reflection and repentance. Rosh Hashanah is also known as Yom Teruah, or the Feast of the Trumpets, because of the blowing of the shofar. And the shofar blasts are a call to remember who God is and his faithfulness. It's also called to usher in the new year with joy and gladness. And it's also to look forward to the coming of the Messiah. But for us as Christians, we recognize that Jesus has come and that we look forward to even greater glory in the second coming of Christ. The Jewish people pray what's called Selichot prayers during this time. And these are based on 13 attributes of God's mercy as seen in the Hebrew text of Exodus 34, verses 6 to 7. And these prayers ground us in the character and the nature of God, and they bring us to a place of repentance as well as thanksgiving for who he is. And so today, we want to invite you all to pray through several of these 13 attributes with us. Pray for revelation of Christ amongst the Jewish people as they usher in the new year and as they pray these prayers themselves. And so for each attribute, we'll give thanks and we'll pray through our own beliefs in who God is, and then we'll prophesy those things, those revelations over the Jewish people. So as I pray, I invite you to come into agreement with me and follow along by lifting up your own intercession. God, you are creator and king. We declare that you are the author, the creator of all things, that you are mighty and awesome, that none can compare. You are holy, you are set apart. We declare your lordship, your authority in our lives and in this earth. And God, we pray for revelation, a greater revelation of your authority in our lives that would lead us to a place of full surrender, of knowing, God, that you alone are worthy of giving this surrender, of trusting. And we pray for fear of the Lord to come upon us, an acknowledgement of who you are, a right understanding of who you are, of your indisputable wisdom and mercy and kindness and grace. God, reveal your power and glory to us. We declare that you are King. And we prophesy over the Jewish people that as they pray and as they acknowledge this, Lord, that you will give them revelation of Christ, that you will give them revelation that Christ is the firstborn, that Christ was there from the start, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, you are one, and you are there from the start, from creation, and that you have called them, that you've chosen them to come and to know your love. Wait for us to come back to you, to repent, to have a full turning back to you. You give us ample time to reflect and to repent. You never rush us. You never force us. God, would you reveal to us where you have been slow to anger? Reveal to us the areas that we have been slow to receive your mercy. God, for you wait, you long and you wait to have compassion and mercy on us. But we're not always so easy to comply. So God, reveal to us, show us, where have you been slow to anger? Where have you been waiting to show us grace and compassion? What are the things that we have stubbornly held on to, or the things that haven't been pleasing to you? Show us, God, what has hindered love between you and us. Because Lord, we know that's ultimately what you care about. You want to remove all hindrances to love. And this is why you're patient. This is why you're slow to anger. God, reveal this to the Jewish people, that it's not based on their works and their performance, that you're not a God that sits disappointed and angry with them, but that you long to show compassion and mercy. Patiently wait for them to acknowledge your presence, to acknowledge your grace in their lives. So we pray for revelation of Christ, the one who died for them, the one who bled for them, the one who was raised to life again, to show them that there's another way, not the road of performance, not the road of striving, but the road of receiving grace and mercy. Let's pray. Covenant of peace be removed. God, you are abounding in chesed love and loving kindness. We thank you, Lord, that you show this love to both the righteous and the unrighteous. God, that you show kindness to us who lack merit, and you bring us near through your loving kindness. Lord, you're not a God who forces us to believe in who you are. You have nothing to prove to us. You simply are the great I am. But you choose each day to reveal yourself to us so that we might be drawn into you, so that we might know that you've hidden yourself from us, but not too far, not out of our reach, so that we might be transformed into your likeness. We ask that you would move us move our hearts with a revelation of your loving kindness. Remind us, God, of how you've shown this to us throughout our lives, throughout the generations, and how you continue to, how you intend to continue to show your loving kindness. Compel us to consecrate ourselves and dedicate ourselves to a God who is set apart from any other God by a covenantal, unconditional love. Lord, I pray the same revelation over the Jewish people, that you are a God who abounds in loving kindness, that it's impossible to reach the end of your love, that it's by your kindness that we are brought back. It's by your kindness that we turn, that we repent. I pray that they will see the loving eyes of a father who's been waiting for so long for them to come home. I pray that they're met with kindness, that they're met with an embrace, a joyful embrace. Let's pray. Forgives when we sin intentionally, when we sin in rebellion, when we sin even inadvertently. God, you are so eager, you're so willing, you're so ready. Regardless of our sin, you are ready to forgive us when we confess and we repent. Right now we pray for a grace for repentance, a true turning of the heart in order to love you with all of our hearts, soul, mind, and strength. That we would acknowledge our sin, but that we would acknowledge your grace and your forgiveness above that, beyond that. God, we prophesy, Lord, this revelation of forgiveness found in Christ over the Jews. That they would be able to receive this forgiveness. And that because of Christ, they're able to extend the same forgiveness. God, we thank you that you call us, Lord, to be pure. You call us to be ones that live in righteousness, that walk in righteousness, and that choose the narrow road to life. But again, it's not by our works. It's not by any willing ourselves to get to that place, but it's simply receiving your forgiveness. We thank you that this love doesn't make sense, that your forgiveness doesn't make sense, and yet we're still able to receive it again and again, and that we're able to give it again and again, because it's your Spirit that empowers us. Let's pray.
Thank you.
intentionally examine ourselves, to invite you in to examine us. We thank you that this prayer time tonight was simply a start, an invitation to greater reflection and repentance, to greater awe of who you are. Lord, we ask that you would give us the time and space for us to continue this process with you, to be unafraid of what will be revealed. Because what will be revealed is greater understanding of your goodness and kindness and mercy. And Lord, we pray that for the Jews around the world celebrating Rosh Hashanah, you would bring revelation of Christ, their Messiah, the one who has already come to save them and who will come back again. May their eyes be open to see how all their holidays, their traditions, their prayers are designed by you to point them to Christ. God, we ask for increasing testimonies of salvation among the Jews, that they'd go on to teach and boldly proclaim the good news to Gentiles and Jews alike. We thank you, God, for this new year, and we enter in with expectation for the sweetness and the joy that lie ahead in full fellowship with you. We pray all of this in Jesus' mighty name.
Thank you for